go. You doing an intro? Oh yeah, I got the thumbs up from Harv. So, all right, I'm just gonna stand up real quick instead of sitting down here. So, welcome to our Securing Your Sanity panel. My name is Michael Spaling. In my professional life, I lead the information security team at the University of Alberta. Mental health has been a pretty outspoken thing for myself in the last recent years. I've been talking about it quite regularly at various conferences and talking about my own personal experiences with it. And this year for BSides Edmonton, we decided, why don't we do a panel? I think it takes a lot of courage and guts to get in front of a room of people and talk about yourself, be quite vulnerable, talk about your issues that you've had with it, talk about things that aren't maybe necessarily easy to talk about. So we were blessed to find four amazing people who have all sorts of different experiences when it comes to cybersecurity, no cybersecurity experience at all, and mental health. So I'm gonna stop there. And what we're gonna do, we have a handful of questions. I'm just gonna pass it down the line. And we'll get started. So, very first question, just introductions and personal journeys. So we'll start with this end of the thing. And share your name, role in the community, and just briefly touch on your personal, professional experiences with mental health, including maybe some key turning points.
Sure. My name is Ernestina Malero. I'm the founder of an e-learning company, Uplift Learning. And we develop and deliver online and blended training. And we specifically also focus on delivering training about workplace resilience, because when you understand what it builds and affects resilience, it's very tied into workplace mental health. Anyhow, personally, my journey with mental health has been really a lifelong journey, right? I've dealt with long periods of depression and also PTSD, and it was actually my own lived experience that drew me into grad school to actually do research around PTSD and really start to get a handle on, you know, what's the connection between our lived experience and the state of our mental health. And so that research it upended my whole life. Just changed my whole view about how mental health is, and gave me a chance to look at the research that's, you know, 40 years old, but isn't yet commonly understood by healthcare professionals or the public, but it's something that really needs to change, that we come to understand how our lived experience affects our mental health. Was that sort of it? I think so.
That was great.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Smaraka. I've been in the IT industry for over 20 years now. I started off as a Microsoft certified system engineer. Darren and I have worked together, so he can't look at me when I say that.
I know how funny that is.
I'm very, very technical. Also, no. NT 4.0, guys, so it was a while ago. And Darren probably wishes I would stop saying that. Working in IT for over 20 years, when I first started my career, I was a freight train and I was going about 100 miles an hour and taking a lot of damage. It was like I had somewhere to go and I was going to get there plowing through. And I started working for an organization and they did a training called Colors and it Personality Profiles. And that was the first time I realized that how I was built, but also how others were built. It also changed kind of like the trajectory of how I saw people, how I thought about myself, and my mental health journey, I guess. So happy to share some insights as the questions evolved, and very nice to see you all.
One thing I want to bring up real quick. Don't feel bad about the NT 4.0. So if you see Bud's shirt, Bud is actually wearing a shirt. It literally says, I took a picture of it earlier, Microsoft Windows 2000 Global Launch Partner. So nice. I think you beat him with 4.0,
I'm
young,
school.
I don't want to make it an ageism thing, but we wanted some more experienced people on the panel, so
right.
I thought I won it with Bud, but...
Well, also, right, like I feel like the conference badge also lends to,
pretty awesome.
You know, 4.0. Yeah.
Awesome. Go for it, Darren.
I can tease you, but I was right at that NT4 as well, so it's fun to tease, but I was there. My name is Darren Guinan. I've been in IT now for about 25 years, security about 18. My story is more, I joined pre-sales, technical pre-sales for a public company, and if you understand that, that means public company means stock, which means pressure, everything is based off of. You gotta be driving that stock up. And that pressure comes from the top down. So over my career, I've had some moments where definitely anxiety played a role. And it really definitely affected my sleep, where I'm at night and my mind is going a mile million miles and I'm just sitting there all night and I look at the clock and it's 8 a.m. and I'm starting the next day with no sleep. So I've definitely seen how that progressed. And then we had COVID hit, right? How did COVID help all our mental states? It didn't help. I went from flying 78 flights 1 year to zero and working in a, what I call my dungeon, a basement. And that was not good for my mental health, which led me to actually quit my job, take a break, refocus, take that high pressure off, and try to figure out what I wanted to do next and find the right place to go that fit my own personal policy. So that's my story.
Great, take it away, Bud.
Okay. My name is Bud Venn, and I've been in IT since 1985. So I represent, I guess, the aging side of this population. I would be a gray beard, I guess, is what we call those old people. But I have alopecia, so that is not an option. I had spent 17 years at EPS, Edmonton Police Service, which I consider quite a stressful IT role, managing cybersecurity. And that is really my story of stress. All the other employers I have had, the job wasn't really that stressful and didn't cause health issues. So my hope today is that I can influence you guys and talk to you about this. And I really have to pay a lot of tribute to Michael. Michael, who helped me understand that the stigma of having mental health issues should be ignored. I mean, we're all people, we're all human beings. We should be able to assess where we're at and treat ourselves accordingly. So,
normalize. If we all start talking about it, it takes the stigma away and it's an everyday thing.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. So normalizing, I didn't talk about my history real much. This is gonna be the most pretentious thing I'll ever say, but just search my name on YouTube. You can find videos that I've talked about at other conferences, so I won't go into the details there, but my history goes back many, many, many years. Hit a massive breaking point in 2018. There were days where I was calling in sick to work because I physically could not get out of bed. I couldn't get in my car and drive more than like 10 minutes without having a panic attack. It was pretty rough. I ended up seeing a therapist, so I see a therapist once a month for the last 5 years now. And one of the key things that she's taught me over the years is to normalize it. It's okay to talk about it. I can be quite vocal and opinionated about all sorts of stuff, so I have no problem standing up here talking about, my mental health was a train wreck. It's a lot better now, but I learned in talking to so many people in the community, especially Bud, that it hits everybody, whether you've been doing this for decades, whether you were doing computers in 1985 or you weren't even born yet. It hits everyone. Just a show of hands if you're willing. Like, who here is stressed out? Who here is anxious? Who here is, if you don't put your hand up, put your hand up. We're all stressed out to some degree. So it's universal, right? What do they say? Everybody has to deal with death and taxes. It's like death, taxes, and stress and anxiety and mental health. So we'll get into the next set of questions here. One thing that I wanted to talk about was culture and stigma around mental health. I think this was a good segue into it. So how do you perceive the current culture around mental health in cybersecurity? And have you faced any stigmas discussing it? And also, how does diversity intersect with some of those challenges? So I'm just gonna throw it to the panel, and if anybody has answers, just throw them out there.
I heard a good saying one time, also came from a therapist, and I am a huge advocate of therapy. I think it's extremely important and essential. I think that every human should have therapy. But the therapist said, what other people think about you is none of your business. And I'm just gonna say that again. What other people think of you is none of your business. So that doesn't mean that you can, do whatever you want or like act in a certain way, but you're never gonna be everybody's cup of tea, and there is a certain freedom to staying true to yourself, and whether that's being up here talking about advocacy for mental health or being vulnerable about your journey. Some people might not be ready to be there. Some people might have feelings or judgment on that, but that's none of your business. Your business is you and the path that you want to go down. And I think that culturally that it can set the tone and make it safe for others who maybe are at the beginning of that journey.
I think that's a great saying. My personal opinion is looking around and being in a number of organizations, there's definitely still a stigma. Not enough people are talking about it. I think people are afraid that maybe it perhaps makes them feel that weak, or maybe they think if management or somebody in an organization knows about, hey, they struggle with mental health, that maybe they're not able to take on another position, maybe a higher level position. So the way I kind of look at it, I'm trying to normalize it as much as possible, talk about it as much as possible, keep throwing out there. You know, me and you have had a lot of conversation. Most of our lunches, we talk about mental health more than IT nowadays. So to me, the more we keep talking about it, we get rid of that stigma.
I'll add real quick to that. Yeah, so like Bud and I, we have lunch maybe once a quarter. And to Darren's point too, like, we don't really talk about computers anymore. You know, we don't really talk about IT anymore. It's more, how are you, you know, it's not so much how are you doing, it's how are you feeling? Like, what's going on in your life these days? And same with Darren. Darren will come to university and we'll have lunch, and it doesn't even have to be like a formal setting. It's just these nice one-on-one discussions with people. You can be open and honest with each other. My therapist said something very similar. So for my personal issues, what she said was, Michael, if other people think you're great at your role, that's their problem. And that was like, no one had ever said that to me, because I was always chasing these achievements and these ambitions, and I had to look good and be awesome. And one day she's just like, Michael, but if people think that, that's their problem, not yours. And I was like, I never even thought of it that way. And it just allows you to just relax, chill, and stop worrying about what other people think of you.
And use your own internal compass, yeah. Right? Like your own set of values that you think are important.
Yeah. Yeah, I was having actually this conversation literally like 5 minutes ago about, you know, I was just sitting out there by myself, just looking at my phone, catching up on stuff, and like I was feeling good. And I was like, normally I would have been, you know, felt obligated to attend a talk or go do this or go do that. And it was like, no, I'm allowed to just sit here and do what I need to do. So anything you want to add to that, Ernestina?
Sure. When I think of workplace culture and just generally the attitudes that we find towards mental health in society, the conversation needs to change. Currently, whether it's spoken or not, when you're dealing with mental health issue, what's not often said is, maybe what's unspoken is that the stigma is around, well, what's wrong with you? What's wrong with you if you can't keep putting up 80 hours a week and trying to deal with the rest of your life? What's wrong with you that you can't keep up? And really the conversation needs to change to, you know, at work and everywhere towards what's happened to you. Right? Is it normal for anyone to be able to work that much for so long? And our sort of like grind culture, you know, productivity culture, it needs to be really re-examined, because human beings, you know, we need more than 80-hour work weeks to be healthy and to be functional. So when I'm thinking of things at work like workplace burnout and that kind of thing, we need to really start thinking about what is the support that the culture, that the workplace needs to offer, that we need to offer one another as staff. Those are some of the things that come to mind about workplace culture. And when it comes to, say, people of color, different cultures, that those folks might go about their wellness practices in a different way, and that also needs to be considered. I'm thinking of my Indigenous friends, for example, and how they approach workplace wellness in different ways, and to make space for people that come from different cultures and have different backgrounds. So those are two sort of lenses on culture that come to mind. So it's not what's wrong with you, it's what's happened to you or what have you been going through. And it's totally predictable that after a pandemic, like, you know, mass collective trauma, right? A loss of choice, a loss of control, increased sense of helplessness. Those are the key drivers that affect our mental health at work and personally, right? And so it makes perfect sense that we're having a mental health crisis after a pandemic, because that's what happened, right? Whenever we lose a sense of choice, control, and feel helpless, that is when we're most likely to have significant impacts to our mental health and workplace mental health.
I'm hoping maybe the whole COVID and making the mental health pandemic, like a second part of it, is maybe now we're putting enough exposure to mental health that maybe in the long run it will help.
I really like that.
Yeah. It was interesting for me, because like I've been seeing a therapist for 2 years pre-pandemic, and then it was fascinating just to hear her advice on how things changed in those initial months when everybody had to adjust to working from home and not being around people. And then 3 years later, now seeing the opposite of those adjustments, and now seeing people having that's become normalized, and now having to talk about the issues with people maybe wanting to have to come back to work or not wanting to come back to work. And you know, we're kind of 3 years into this interesting social experiment. Like, I can tell you, had I not been going to therapy for the last 3 years, I would not have dealt with COVID nearly as well as I had. Bud, was there anything you wanted to add on the diversity side?
I was going to add one thing about the soft stigma, or the stigma in itself. There's this soft piece that I hope maybe I can get through to people. If you don't think that mental health is something that will ever affect you, you may not be aware of the programs available through your employer. I think I felt that way. Is there a phone number to call? Or is there, how do you start the ball rolling? If you turn the corner as a result of realizing that you're having a mental health problem, however the many ways that happens, are you aware of what's available through your employer? And how do you start the ball rolling? I feel that's a piece of ignorance that I think I had and maybe other people have had. So I thought I'd bring that up.
So I think that actually leads right into our next point. I'm sitting here kind of thinking like we sound a little depressed, which might be part of the panel. Let's spruce it up a little bit. Let's talk about how we've been doing better. Education and initiatives. What educational resources, strategies, and support services have you used to teach yourself and others about mental health? Let's focus on some of the good stuff that's gotten us to where we are today. And again, I'll throw it to the panel.
I think this is probably a good time to talk about when Darren and I worked together, and back to what I was talking about with colors or Myers-Briggs or personality profiling. Because I had done it in the job that when I came into the employer that Darren and I worked for, there were culturally some hard undertones that were happening within the teams. And so one of the things that I did was, knowing how impactful it was for me, is I brought colors into for the team to do. And I also invited their spouses to attend, because it was, you know, you're a whole person. You're not just a professional version and a personal version. And sometimes I certainly encountered this is how, once I found out how I was built, and so I have probably like a lot of you in here have a data brain that wants all the information about all things, but I'm also very impulsive, and so I have a hard time sitting down for a long period of time to get that information. And a person like me that is moving very quickly and speaks quickly, thinks quickly, can be chaotic for people that maybe are emotion-based or maybe like structure or like to do a sequential task. And so I would guess, if you think about your spouse or your partner or your significant other, probably the opposite of you. Like, I don't know why that happens in life, but we tend to attract the exact opposite person of how we are. So when I went through that, I was like, oh, that makes sense. This, I'm built this way. I'm married to this person. And so I thought with the team, let's help them understand each other and the strengths that each of us bring. Some are emotion-based, some are data-based. And then also their spouses, I think there was just a lot of like good learning there.
It was, as the person who took it from what you organized, and I brought my wife to it, I found it so valuable to understand my own personality, understand where my wife fit. And then one of the coworkers that we worked with went and sat with my wife on the 100% emotional side. And I was like, I would have never guessed that.
Surprising.
And every day I came to work and I had a desk that faced him. We faced each other. And every day he's nice and happy. And this one day he came in and he did not look good. And I remember thinking, okay, I understand he's really emotional. I just looked at him. I go, do you need a hug? And he's like, yeah, I need a hug. And that was very foreign for me, but I got up, he came over and gave him a hug, and he instantly relaxed and he felt better for the day.
I love that.
But the fact that you know the personality, and that was, I'm not the huggy type, but I understood what he needed.
What, really?
Yeah.
You gave me a huge hug when you saw me earlier.
I sensed you needed it.
Yeah, okay.
But anyway, it's I think understanding your personality, understanding how you can relate to others and how you can help others is so valuable. My own personal journey on trying to manage my own mental health and that, I definitely know that when things get tough, I stop wanting to exercise and do those things that I need the most. Like Michael, I ended up seeing a psychologist for a number of years. I found it very valuable not only to be able to talk to somebody third party that I didn't necessarily know everything thing about me, but also felt that I could be very open and get another opinion. And she also directed me a lot of ways, like, hey, you're in this situation, you should protect yourself this way. So it felt like I had somebody else in my corner, which is really, really good.
It's a subject matter expert too, right?
Right.
Like if I had anything to do, like a security, like question, or I would go to Darren because he's a subject matter expert in that. It's the same with mental health, right? Like we're not subject matter experts on it. We go to professionals who have done all of the schooling, the education, have been in it for years, seen a large data set of different mental health, issues, and then they can guide you through that. So I think I love that you're going to see that person and they can help.
One thing speaking of subject matter experts, so Ernestina, you did your research in this, and you have a company that offers educational resources as a service. So if it's something you want to, not to interrupt you guys, just curious, what did you, let's hear what you have to say on that topic too.
Sure. When I went into looking at trauma research, that's sort of like going into the dark side. It's really heavy, and thinking about how that plays out in the workplace in terms of like workplace aggression, bullying, those kinds of really difficult behaviors. But that's sort of why I ended up on the topic of resilience, because we need to balance, we need to be honest about like what's difficult at work, but we also need to take the time to look at ourselves and say, well, what have I got going for me? What are my strengths? What do I bring to the table? And where do I need to, what are the skills that I might need to learn to boost my resilience? How can I have more compassion? How can I show up better for my colleagues? And actually, I think this message needs to come to leaders, right? Because leaders are the ones that can really make the difference in terms of creating environments that are safe enough for staff to speak about what they need. And we need to start having different kinds of conversations in the workplace around workplace mental health and resilience. So for me, when I'm thinking about resilience, that's one of the core things is thinking about, what strengths do I already have, and where might I be able to learn and grow? What are the skill sets that that might accompany resilience? And some of those skill sets are things like, what are my communication skills like? How am I at resolving conflict, right? Conflicts being like, this is kind of a scary, touchy subject that probably not very many of us like, but our communication skills really affect our ability to advocate for ourselves and to also deal with conflict at work. So I think there's quite a few levels to it, that I address in the training that I offer.
One thing I noticed, just so everybody's aware, so these questions were all shared last week with the panelists. We've had some time to think about them. But I noticed in that email chain, your email signature says, yours in resilience, followed by your name. And I'll be honest, the first time I read that, I didn't know what that meant. Mm. So I went and Googled it and learned, there's this whole, I found some of your stuff and some talks on YouTube on resilience and learned quite a bit of that. I'm going to go to the next question here, but I want to start with you on this one, as I think this was on the managerial side of things. So for those in managerial roles, how do you identify and support team members facing mental health challenges? And how can peer support and mentorship assist individuals? So take it away.
That's a tough one. I think that one of the things we're going to be watching for is changes in behavior and unusual things that are happening but I don't feel that I'm an expert in observing that type of stuff and observing people. I know that the five or six guys that work for me, we all talked every day and tried to share a lot of stuff, but I don't think I really had too much insight into how we would try and help our coworker and say, you're having a tough time. How have you explored the options for helping yourself? I mean, we do just normally. I don't think it's anything above and beyond a normal work relationship, in my experience.
I've been in leadership for about 15 years, and I think it's what you already talked about. It's that connection and education to what your employer has to offer. I think it's vulnerability, which you have displayed. And when you sit down with somebody, like the two of you go for lunch, you know that there's a place of vulnerability there. And I think when you have people reporting to you, they can sense that. They know whether it's safe to share something that they're worried about judgment or that they could be terminated or that there will be backlash. And so I think you as a leader model that and create that safe space. And I've been in organizations where above me is not safe. So I create a protective shield around the people that are on my team so that that allows them. And sometimes I'll sit down with them and say, how are you doing? If I'm seeing any of that type of, like, if I'm sensing that something's off, I'll say, oh, like, how are things going? How many of you here have said, good? Yeah? Good? We're all great. Super. Like, no, we're not great. Like, we're stressed out. We're
That just means it's not safe. And I think what we're going to see over the next 10 years in workplace mental health is actually a really strong shift towards workplace psychological safety. Canada's a leader in developing a psychological safety standard that's being adopted by World Health Organization. And so building and developing psychological safety at work is probably something that's going to make a pretty tremendous difference, meaning that people will feel safe enough to express their concerns, safe enough to ask for help that they need and the support that they need without fear of reprisal and being fired and that kind of thing. So I think that's a trend that's coming that we're going to be seeing. And I think what leaders, you know, something for leaders to consider is to, you know, getting psychological safety training, right? And then, but also training, with training, it's the minute training is over is sort of when training starts. So we also have to start thinking about, you know, what's the learning retention on these kinds of trainings. So that's something also to consider. Yeah.
It's funny, Bud, you said it's difficult, like as a manager, you know, to kind of start those conversations. I've experienced that myself. Mm-hmm. A smarter moderator would have just deleted this question, so we sound better. But it is a challenge. So almost my entire team is in this room right now. I'm not going to out them out. They know who they are. But I loved your comment about good. I had a director I used to report to, and every time, you know, he'd see me, he'd be like, "How you doing, Michael?" And I would say one of three things: I'm either good, I'm busy, or I'm tired. And one day he said to me, "He goes, you can't say that anymore." He goes, awesome. "Everyone's good, everyone's busy, everyone's tired." He would say something more interesting. And I don't enforce it across my team, but I have one direct report who does it consistently, and I'm pretty sure it's just to troll me now. Or every time, because they know this, right? And it's like, "So how you doing? Good." I'm like, "Oh, I can't tell if you're serious or if you're just like trolling me." But it is true, right? And part of it, I learned, like, it was a coping strategy where maybe I didn't necessarily feel the trust that I wanted to, because yeah, there was a lot of stuff I wanted to talk about, but not necessarily with that supervisor.
Yeah.
You know, so when I would say, "Oh, I'm good," or "Oh, I'm busy," or "Oh, I'm tired," it was a polite way of me saying, "I don't want to talk right now."
Yeah.
But at least, I mean, not to that person. So yeah, the thing about building out trust, mm-hmm. I'll sit here and I'll try to tell everybody in this room, I hope I've built some degree of trust with my team, but knowing that four of the six are here, they might be like, "Yeah, try harder, Michael." I don't know. But
I think it's interesting, though, too, like when you said maybe not with that supervisor, our brain is always scanning for little nuances. So when that supervisor says to you, "You can't say that anymore, say something interesting," it's like, okay, versus say something real. You know, it's like, I want interesting from you. He's not saying I want real from you. And I don't know, but that little nuance might have said to your brain, you know, "Oh, do you mean interesting, like connected to how I'm myself and how I'm doing, or does it mean entertain me?"
Oh yeah, interesting for me would be like, "Guess what I found in a PCAP this morning looking at logs."
Exactly.
That wouldn't go well. That guy'd be like, "I don't care."
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Moving right along. Coping mechanisms and burnout prevention. So share self-care techniques and advice for managing stress and maintaining your mental well-being in the demanding field of cybersecurity. So what have we been doing to kind of help out? I know we talked about it a bit, but let's go a little deeper.
I know for myself, I've kind of, I was put onto a blog, or I shouldn't say a blog, a podcast about leadership, and by my manager. And what I actually found is it was a great session on setting your own personal policy. So it's been really important for me to think about what's important to me and what I know that I need every day to make sure that I keep myself healthy. Making sure I take lunch. Don't get booked down. A lot of times our calendars are open season for people putting stuff in. And I remember at a previous job I put in there, I was working like 10-hour days at lunch, and my manager was like, "That's the silliest thing I've ever said." I'm like, "Take it out." And I'm like, "Well, if I can never figure out a time to get lunch, then I'm going to get more grumpy as I'm hungry." But the point is, you should be taking your breaks. You should be taking your lunch. If you need to schedule some time to read something in your industry still relevant to your job, but it helps you relax. You should be putting those mechanisms in. And in my opinion, a good workplace, good manager will support you with that and help you with that instead of making you feel silly or saying something negative about it.
I think we also need to measure things differently. Like I was talking with a couple of coworkers, and right now we're measuring either in society or at work. Like, think of time off. What if there was some type of like AI or analytics that would like auto route that you hadn't taken enough time off, or that you hadn't used any of the services? And I know we can't get sometimes that granular because the information is protected, but I think part of when you're talking about like education, there's like the learning component as leaders, but then if leaders were measuring how much like massage therapy you were doing or how much, you know, time off you were taking in a positive way, because right now sometimes it can feel like we're not supposed to take time off, or we're not, you know, or we're supposed to, like, it's
you might feel guilty even.
Right, or it's good if we work kind of 80 hours. So I think that's like a, and then the other piece of advice that I give to like younger people coming up is like, pay attention to when your brain is happy and point your life towards that. Because in this room, you guys, I'm gonna guess, are all exceptionally smart. Like, whatever you do, you'll be good at it. You can do anything. Whatever you point your big brain towards, you'll be good at that thing. But that doesn't mean you're going to be happy doing that thing. So pay attention when you're happy and when your brain likes something, and try and point your life's path towards that. And I think it won't be such a rub.
I think measurement, too, is a key word, is how we measure. If you think of some of the teams I've been on, is the managers are, our team's always 150% of plan. We're always doing well. But they have people who can't last more than 2 years on the team. Mm-hmm. So I think we have to start measuring not based on that, but on how happy are people. And I will give a plug, Jennifer. To me, you came in when we were in some turmoil in our organization, and you created a safe place where we felt like a team. You took care of the employees first, and then we took care of business. And I think that's a great philosophy, which is Richard Branson's, I think, from Virgin Galactic and everything. That was his. You take care of your team first, they take care of customers. And I truly believe that. Yeah. And a lot of organizations are, no, clients are number one. Well, you see all these people leaving, coming in and out the door all the time. Take care of your staff, they'll take care of the job.
You mentioned that. So when our youngest, so he's 7 now. Nope, he's not 7. He's 8. My wife is going to be here later. Don't tell her I made that mistake. he just turned 8. We got him an RESP shortly after he was born. And I remember the lady at the bank, you know, how long have you been at the University of Alberta? And at that time, it was like, I don't know, 8 or 9 years. And she's like, I've been here 2 years, and I can't wait to get out of here. And like, it was always an interesting thing for me, because like even, you know, people you hear, oh, you've been somewhere for 9 years. I've been at the U of A now for 13 years. And people are like, so when are you going to leave and go experience other jobs? And I was like, but I love my job. I love the people I work
That's
with.
Key.
I stay because of that. And if you ask other university people, thank you, 5 minutes. I'm still early on in my career. Like there's people 35, 40 years. So we just got the 5-minute warning. Let's go to the last question here. Bud, I think I'll pass this one to you. So future outlook and workplace policies. What changes or improvements would you like to see in mental health, and how mental health is addressed in the cybersecurity industry in the future? Any policies or anything our workplaces can do to make this better?
You know, I saw that question when you distributed, and I don't really think I have any good suggestions there, because, I don't want to bash employers or anything like that, but it's just difficult to try and even think of a solution that I could think of. That's for people, I guess, in the industry. But my personal solution is, if anyone wants a therapy they could try out, is retire and golf a lot.
Undergrad, you know, you've
got 30 years to wait, but it's something to look forward to, you know?
Well, can I ask, I want to ask Bud a question. So sure. When you retired, did you now find you had a new set of stress, like what to do with yourself? Did that create another anxiety type? I would think it would.
Stress isn't just the job. Stress
right.
is up here.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I did retire. I'm doing some helpful work for a nonprofit my sister runs, and I still find myself getting pulled into the stress sphere, right?
Yeah.
So that's the other part. Mental health is with you no matter what employer you're at.
I think I'm going to jump in here. The policy that I think everyone should be really watching out for, and I wouldn't surprise, it's going to tie into occupational health and safety more and more in the future, and it's psychological safety. If there's one thing that I could ask everyone to take away, is to start thinking about how do we build more psychological safety at work, because it is something that really affects people's ability to stay at work, to be effective, to prevent burnout, and to decrease the brain drain that comes from people leaving their jobs, right? It's a huge expense when people are like, I can't take it anymore and I'm quitting. That costs everyone so much. So there's a lot of incentive to address these issues.
Why don't we just jump right to the end then? So we had key takeaways, but why don't we just do closing thoughts and resources? So we'll just share your final thoughts and recommended resources or suggestions, and then we'll call it a panel.
I would say for managers, the thing that comes to mind, the ultimate tool anyone can use is curiosity, right? Instead of saying, what's wrong with you? It's like, hey, what's going on for you? Or I've noticed and, you know, I'm here for you. And being curious, bringing curiosity to the table instead of judgment is one of the most powerful tools any of us can use for anyone in our lives, at work or personally. And I think also, like I said, exploring psychological safety and also resilience are key topics that I think need to come into the workplace.
Yeah, I think that's really, I really like that as well. And I think also like seeking to understand. I find that I'm a quick to like react and then I have to like give myself a 5 minute and then I go in with a seek to understand. And if I ask those questions in that way, it will bring down the kind of tension that's happening. And then the other thing that I do within the workplace is I have somebody that is, I can bounce that has my same values, thinks about things the same way that I do, and I have them as a soundboard. And so now, like, I would use Darren as that, right? If I'm in something and I can't see it clearly, or Darren knows me, he knows, like, I can run a little hot or my freight train or whatever, so I'll check in and just say, hey, am I looking at this the right way? Like, you know my dysfunction. I say that lovingly. Do you have another viewpoint? And then I feel safe with him. So he'll share with me what, even if it's hard sometimes, right, about what I could be doing better or validate what I'm saying. So having a person, I think, is really important.
I'll add to that real quick. I've been doing that a little more recently, too. Just being a little more honest about my mistakes. Like, I walk into, you know, my boss's or our CIO's office and just be like, I screwed up. And, you know, I've learned not to just, you know, address it that way, but that's the general gist of it, right? And sometimes it's like, I don't feel good about how I address this situation. I think I upset somebody, which is, it's out of character for me, help. And just to have that other person to bounce it off, absolutely.
So you're demonstrating vulnerability, and you're demonstrating self-reflection.
Yeah, or it's that statement too, like, I won't make that mistake again, or I won't make a mistake, and it's like, oh, don't do that to yourself. Like, you're 100% going to make a mistake. Like, just set that bar. Like, that's what we should measure, your mistakes, and then how you respond to that or react to that.
Darren, take it away.
You guys took a lot of the stuff I was going to say already. I'll finish off with be kind to yourself. So, I mean, it's really hard. If you're really, like me, OCD, that likes everything to be a certain way, and I hold myself to a really high standard, if you make a mistake, you gotta be able to let go. I did a panel about 2 or 3 weeks ago, and I blanked on one of the questions, and I answered it, and I was like, that was the worst answer ever. My manager was like, you did fine, you could have done it differently, but and I didn't sleep a little bit that night, and next night, and I finally had to say to myself, oh my God, just let it go. Do better the next time. Be a little more prepared, think of it differently, and just try to be kind to yourself. So that's what I've done.
Bud, you're the only one standing between yourself and the golf course, so last one.
No pressure.
Last thing I would say is have something that takes you away from work.
Great point.
For me, it's golf. Some people meditate. A lot of people read books, and that puts them in a different world. Have something. You know, we can't work 24/7.
Awesome. Well, that's the panel. I'm not sure if we have time for Q&A or not. I'm looking at the back room there. Michelle, take it away. I think we had a...
Harvinder can make time for us. This is an important
subject. We got 5 minutes. All right, Harv says we have 5 minutes.
No pressure.
There's no lunch out those doors yet.
So. First of all, I wanted to thank all the panel. This is exceptional. I'm a big person who believes in therapy and self-help. I'm transgendered, by the way, and I went through 8 years of therapy to be able to make the decisions that I need to be able to make in my life. So therapy is absolutely critically important. I do have a question, and it is related to my personal experiences from a work perspective. I was with the same employer for 19 years of my life, and then I ended up having a manager change, and that manager was very micromanaging of me. I immediately recognized that I didn't like it, and it's what caused me to leave the company that I was working for. I then made a conscious decision to move to a different company and ultimately ended up reporting to the CEO, who is very narcissistic. And one of the things from a society perspective that I see is that we seem to reward narcissism within managers. All we have to do is take a look at Elon Musk from the perspective of probably the most narcissistic person in the world, but also the richest. And so how have you dealt with micromanagers, narcissism in the work from the perspective of your own mental health? And I wish that we could do this panel for the rest of the day.
No problem.
You know, I just took a deep breath when you said, how do you deal with this? Because I bet you everybody has faced that. It's one of the reasons I left one of my jobs as well, where, you know, you were, somebody's in your calendar every day, checking what you're doing. Justify that you're busy. We're having a meeting. Well, let's have a discussion. I better know everything you're doing. It overwhelms you with the micromanagement. So it, to me, that is so anxious, anxiety building, and makes you so stressed. So I find it very difficult. For me, I almost came back to what one of my therapist said to me was, do you have a mental health issue or do you have a work issue? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I quickly realized that I had a work issue and I quit. Mm-hmm. And I moved on. I think the best thing, and it's not that easy. It's not easy sometimes to quit a job. Don't get me wrong, like we all have, a lot of us could have wives, kids, husbands, etc. It's not so easy to say you're taking a loss of income and you'll be able to function. But I do think that you need to, if you're in those situations, prioritize your mental health and maybe start thinking about an exit plan.
Yeah, I love that. I think for yourself, I think you just did the right thing. Like it's, you have to, if there's a rub happening there, it's going to affect you and you're going to start, like your nervous system is a glass and you can only put so much in there before it starts spilling out, like short-tempered, can't sleep. Those mean that there's something not sitting well. So from a personal standpoint, I love that. From a professional standpoint, when I've been in cultures that have been not great or toxic, I'll start in a roundabout way having conversations about measuring things that I know where the answer is going to lead, like retention. So if I think that somebody is a narcissist or they have a really kind of toxic personality as a leadership level, I'll start bringing up, like, where are we sitting in industry standards for our retention? And, oh, Smart. We're in the bottom percentile, you know, and it's like, what do you guys think at the table that we could do, you know, to help that? And then inevitably the answer, right, becomes, yeah. And you, by the way, board of directors too, like, you know, that's a great way to start saying, do you guys think that there's an issue there with, because it impacts also profitability. Yeah. You start speaking their language and it rolls down, right?
Our vendor's telling us to wrap it up. So, okay. Yes. Cool. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining. That was awesome.
Thank you.
Great.